Do you remember the last time you were on a political talk show?
2021.
So it's been 3 years.
Yes, we were talking about the senatorial elections in 2022.
Uh-oh.
And tinanong mo ako, sabi mo, ano bang plano mo? At sabi ko, we want to unite the opposition.
Yeah.
And that was right before Attorney Lenny decided to run for president.
Okay. Bam, are you running again? Tatakbo ka ba ulit in 2025?
Karen, naghahanda na kami at handa na rin ako bumalik sa larangan ng politika.
Mm-mm.
Handa akong maging boses ng walang boses sa Senado. I'm ready and we're preparing for it.
Okay, what made you decide to run again?
Well, alam mo, makikita mo yung bansa natin, ang raming mga kababayan natin, pakiramdam nila, hindi sila napapakinggan.
Mm-hmm.
Nag-aaway yung mga partido, yung pag-focus ngayon sa presyo ng bilihin, sa taas ng sahod, hindi talaga siya nabibigyan ng pansin. And I think more people who want to bring back the issues dun sa pangangailangan ng taong bayan need to engage and be part of the political process.
Okay. So pag-usapan natin, no? Matindi ang talo ng otso diretso noon.
Yes.
That's one. And then former Senator Laila De Lima announced that you, Shel Diokno, and Senator Kiko Pangilinan would be running altogether in the Liberal Party, which you're not. So, isa pa yun.
Actually, kami ni Chel Diokno are not part of the Liberal Party. Chel and I are part of KNP.
Mm-mm.
So, kwento ko ng konti, Karen, yung genesis ng KNP. After 2019, umalis na ako sa Liberal Party, but because I was a private citizen, di na namin siya nilabas sa publiko. No? And in 2021, when we were preparing for VP Lenny at that time to run, nabuo yung KNP.
Mm-hmm.
At yung nagbuo nito, mga young board members, young councilors, all of these young leaders, very dynamic, very innovative, malalim yung pagmamahal sa bayan, binuo nila yan para may ibang vehicle si Attorney Lenny na tumakbo in 2022.
Mm-hmm. Na hindi LP.
In the end, she decided to run as an independent. And after the elections, nag-usap-usap sila, and at this time I was still advising them, itutuloy pa ba yung partidong to? And sabi nila, ang laki ng naipakita natin nung kampanya. Hindi man tayo nagwagi, pero yung paglabas ng tao, yung klarong paghangad ng tao for something better in our country, nakita natin, naramdaman natin yan.
Mm.
Sayang naman kung mawawala. And now that we're 1 year before 2025 and everyone's preparing already, hiniling nila na maging chairman ako ng partido. And
oh.
I said yes. So,
pero sino ang nasa KNP?
Yes.
So you have civil society, kabataan?
We actually have a lot of incumbents.
Okay.
We have people like board member Kirby Salazar, si Councilor Maya Bongko, Councilor Burns Olivares, former Councilor Maybelline de la Cruz. These are all young leaders. Sila yung superstar in their own provinces. At sila rin yung naging provincial heads nung campaign ni VP Lenny in 2022. So marami dito, nakasama ko na sa kampanya nung 2022, nagbuo, and the groups are still there, Karen. Yun yung magandang pangitain dito is that at the end of 2022, agad-agad marami sa kanila nag-organisa na ulit. They organized again, and they invited me to go all over the Philippines to meet all the volunteers. At nakita ko, na kahit di natin nakamit yung gusto natin in 2022, yung paghahangad ng mas magandang bansa, nandun pa rin.
Okay.
So, the challenge was, itutuloy ba natin to 2025 and beyond? And the answer was, yes, isa itong magandang gawin para sa taong bayan. And when they asked me to lead the party as chairman, pumayag ako. And now I am the chairman of the newest political party in the Philippines.
Okay. What's interesting is the fact that most Filipinos have lived with a Marcos Aquino history.
Mm-hmm.
And here you are running as senator again with your former nemesis, the family's nemesis, as a sitting president. Mm-hmm. Hindi mo ba napag-isipan yun na, o ba't ako tatakbong senador ngayon na ang nakaupo si Pangulong Ferdinand Marcos Jr.?
Well, actually, Karen, sa totoo lang yung paghangad mo na tumulong, hindi mo talaga masyadong naiisip sino ba yung nakaupo. O basta ang intention ko lang, makatulong ulit sa taong bayan. Now, if you look at our history, may President Marcos Sr., may Senator Aquino, and then nung time ni Pinoy, may President Aquino at may Senator Marcos.
That's so interesting.
Who's now the president, di ba?
Oo nga, no.
So baka nga kailangan ng balance in the force, sabi nila. Hindi ko alam. I don't know. But
that's so interesting that when Pinoy was president, BBM was a senator.
Yes, yes.
And that was a surprise too because that was his first term.
Yes. And, but alam mo, honestly,
yeah.
Beyond family names,
yeah.
Ang nakikita ko talaga, maraming issue yung mga kababayan natin na hindi nabibigyan ng tamang pansin. Mm. Yung presyo ng bilihin, pagtaas ng sahod, our education crisis, napakaraming issue na kailangang itackle. And hindi madadali yung mga isyong to, Karen.
Yeah. But clearly, you believe your voice is needed.
Of course. They're very complicated issues. Hindi sila madadaling i-resolve. Marami kang kailangan banggain para makamit mo yung mga kailangan mo makamit para sa taong bayan. At kailangan natin ng mga tao na handang magtrabaho, handang panindigan yung mga walang boses, handang bumangga kung kailangan bumangga. And I'd like to think, kaya natin yan. And sana, yung iba pang mga kababayan natin na kaya rin nila, sana tumakbo rin sila at maging part nitong political process natin.
Okay, so some political questions first before we go to the issues. President Marcos Jr. is right now consolidating alliances because, you know, some analysts have said there's a proxy war between the Marcoses and the Dutertes. You've seen both of this in history. Mm-hmm. Marcos Sr. and the Duterte, you were a sitting senator then, no?
Yes.
Pag-usapan natin ito, if President Marcos Jr. reaches out to KNP
okay,
and asks you to be part of the unity team, where would you stand with that?
Oh, unang-una, Karen, wala pa namang pag-uusap na ganyan, di ba? But para sa akin, kung magkakaroon ng alliance, para saan? Di ba? Kung ang alliance mo para lang sa eleksyon, nakita natin within 1.5 years, wala na yan. Di ba? Your analyst earlier said, para nagpapalit lang ng
color ng uniform.
Pero kung may alliance para sa talagang kailangan ng taong bayan, why not? You know, lahat kami na public servant, pangalawa lang kami sa pangangailangan ng taong bayan. And I've shown this already, Karen, no? During the time of President Duterte, yung batas para sa libreng kolehiyo na sinulong ko, pinirmahan ni President Duterte. Implemented during his time, still implemented now. Secretary Ralph said they will fully implement the free college law. And nagawa mo yan kahit magkakaiba kayong partido. So may mga issue tayo na mas mahalaga sa mga tao, mas mahalaga sa mga partido. Kung yan ang batayan, if we can really move our country forward, maaangat natin yung bansa natin dahil magtutulungan, why not? Pero right now, nakikita natin yung mga alyansa, base lang sa kapangyarihan.
So if you do win as a senator again, is it fair to say you'll be part of the opposition?
Ang opposition kasi sa Senado, Karen, depends on your vote for the Senate President. So hindi siya necessarily the same as the opposition in
the lower house
or in national politics, 'di ba? But ito siguro yung mahalaga. Kung tayo makabalik sa Senado, ang ipapasa nating batas, naka-focus 'yan sa pagbaba ng presyo ng bilihin, pagtaas ng sahod ng mga manggagawa at pagsigurado na yung benepisyo ng tao makukuha talaga ng tao, hindi makukurap. And whether you're in the minority or the majority, kung yung mga batas mo maganda at makakatulong gaya ng libreng kolehiyo, makakakukuha ka ng tulong mula sa iba't ibang partido. And again, if you're a senator, you need the president to sign your law. So I'd like to think may mga issue na mas mahalaga sa amin at kahit malalim yung mga problema historically, kung ito para sa bayan, pwede tayong magtulungan kung makakatulong talaga to sa taong bayan.
Okay. So you've talked about, it's really about issues. Let's go to that. In the 19th Congress, this was in 2018, you spoke against charter change, right?
Yes.
You asked for the passage of the anti-dynasty law. The current president, President Marcos Jr., wants changes in the charter, economic changes. Sang-ayon ka ba dun?
Some economic changes, yes. Unang-una, allowing more competition in the Philippines. Alam mo naman, Karen, we talked about this many years ago. Ako rin yung nagsulong ng Competition Act sa Pilipinas. So yung pagbukas ng ekonomiya natin, para yung maliliit, mas kaya makipagkompetensya sa malalaki, kailangan natin yan. Para hindi tayo kontrolado ng ilang kumpanya lang o ilang mga pamilya lang. So there are economic changes that we can look at. Political changes, hindi ako masyadong in favor. Sa totoo lang, I might think twice about it kung uunahin natin yung anti-political dynasty law. Kung uunahin natin yan, then I think we can look at maybe some of these changes. Pero habang kontrolado tayo ng ilang pamilya lang, yung political system natin, parang mahirap ibukas yung konstitusyon natin sa mga political changes.
But then what makes you optimistic that the anti-dynasty law will ever pass when in the Senate alone you have brothers and sisters there, right? You have siblings, you've had mother and son. You have mother and son
okay,
today,
Karen,
right? You have family members sitting in the Senate together.
I think it's a law na whose time has come. May mga ganyan eh. May mga batas na maganda pero hindi pa niya oras. Ito, matagal na dapat itong napasa. And maybe it will come to a point where the time has come for the anti-political dynasty law to get passed. Mm. The only anti-political dynasty clause in any law in the Philippines is in the SK Reform Act. Mm. Sino yung mga nagsulong ng batas na yan?
Kabataan.
In the SK. So sa SK ngayon, hindi ka pwedeng may kamag-anak na kapitan, mayor, senator, or president. That's the only law in the Philippines na may anti-political dynasty clause. Who pushed for that law? Senator Aquino, Senator Marcos, Senator Binay, Senator Ejercito.
Even
lahat galing sa political family.
Oh. Interesting.
Yes. So, that's in the records. Between Aquino, Marcos, Binay, and Ejercito, napasa namin ng SK Reform Act. And there were others in Congress na galing rin sa mga political family. Pero at that time, nakita namin na mahalaga para sa SK, para gumanda yung SK, magkatotoong reform yung SK, na ilagay yung anti-political dynasty clause doon. So ibig ko lang sabihin, there will come a time na makikita ng mga tao na kailangan na nating ibukas ang politika natin. Mm-hmm. At kung hindi yan gagawin ng mga currently nasa posisyon, gagawin yan ng mga papalit sa kanila. So they better do it soon, di ba? Mm-hmm. So all of these laws, Karen, marami nagsasabi, imposibleng magka-anti-political dynasty sa Pilipinas. We have a law that has that. Mm. Imposible na maging libre yung kolehiyo. When we were young, parang di mo maisip, but we got it done. So these big reforms, kayang gawin yan. Kung handa ka magtrabaho, handa ka makinig, handa ka makipagtulungan, you can get these big reforms done. At yun yung hinahanap ng tao, hindi away right now.
Okay. So kapag nanalo ka, what is your priority? I mean, this wouldn't be your first time in the Senate if you win.
Ang priority natin, Karen, is really yung hirap ng buhay ng tao. Paano to maiibsan? Ibaba ang presyo ng bilihin.
But is that a law? Is that legislation?
Yes, it's legislation. It's looking at the budget so the agencies can do their work. Unang-una, yung pagbaba ng presyo ng bilihin. Ang babanggain mo dyan, mga kartel, mga smuggler, mga sindikato sa loob at labas ng gobyerno. Kung yung corruption na yan mawala, ang presyo ng bilihin natin posibleng bumaba. Yung pagtaas ng sahod ng mga kababayan natin, ito ang babanggain mo dyan, mga malalaking kumpanya, big business. Babanggain mo dyan, iba't ibang mga grupo na ngayon gustong panatiliing ganyang level lang yung minimum wage natin. So para magawa yan, you really have to get everybody together and make an effort na talagang gawin natin yan para sa taong bayan. If you look at all of the surveys, and when I go around, ito rin sinasabi ng mga tao, Senator, kahit nagtatrabaho ako, 8 hours a day, 6 days a week, hindi ko pa rin makuha yung kailangan ko para sa pamilya ko. So that equation needs to be resolved. Paano tataas yung sweldo? Paano bababa yung presyo ng bilihin? Paano sisiguruduhin na yung benepisyo mo, makukuha mo talaga? And if we can focus on that, everybody, kung yan ang focus natin, palagay ko yung taong bayan, matutuwa sila at makikita nila kayang umangat ng ating bansa.
Okay. In 2017, you also called on the government, this was during the time of former President Duterte, to end the brutal killings and rethink the drug war.
Yes.
Right. So how would you compare the drug war of former President Duterte to President Marcos's now?
Oh, very different, di ba? Ibang-iba. And I think the President and si Secretary Abalos has said na pagdating sa pagsumpo sa droga, susunod sila sa mga patakaran ng ng ating mga batas, no? And mahalaga 'yan. Mahalaga 'yan. So, Karen, again, so, I'm sure yung tanong kasi diyan, tutol ka ba sa lahat ng ginagawa ng administrasyon, no? Pagdating sa drug war, I think they're doing it better now. Pagdating sa ating foreign policy, and I have to give props to Secretary Gibo, no? He's doing a good job, Secretary Manalo of DFA. They're doing their best to really fight for our territory. At yan yung mga bagay na palagay ko we have to set aside politics and we should just come together to support our country laban sa threat ng China sa ating bansa.
Okay, before we go to the West Philippine Sea, so the big discussion now is the International Criminal Court or the ICC. should the Philippines become a member once again of the ICC? And should President Marcos Jr. cooperate with the ICC?
I was not in favor of pulling out of the ICC during President Duterte's time. So I don't think my position will change. Mm-hmm. Pero yung isang hindi na pag-uusapan ka rin ito eh. No? In the end, ang ICC is a process, is a foreign process. No? What about our local processes? Hindi ba yun ang kailangan rin nating hanapin sa gobyerno ngayon na yung mga pinatay, namatay, mga hindi dapat pinatay, nasaan yung justisya para sa kanila? No? During the time I was in the Senate, kausap ko yung mga nanay ng mga pinatay sa mga urban poor areas. At lahat sila mahihirap. No? At napakasakit naman kung yung justisya para sa kanila makukuha sa Hague. Hindi nila makukuha yung justisya dito sa ating bansa. So if you ask me, yes, we should rejoin the ICC, but shouldn't we demand from our government na maimbestiga ito ng maayos dito sa ating bansa?
Okay, so those are two things. So right now, the Department of Justice is preparing a briefer
for the ICC.
For President Marcos Jr. in case a warrant gets issued against certain personalities.
But Karen, again, you're looking at a foreign process, di ba? Mm. Nasaan yung local processes natin? Kasi namatay sila sa bansa natin, di ba? So far, dalawa o tatlo pa lang ata yung nakakasuhan, if I'm not mistaken. No? Hindi ba dapat tayo rin mismo, we should have a proper investigation here in our own country? Mm-hmm. Libo-libo yun. Napakarami. And then when I would meet them before, hindi sila kukonti ng 50, isang daan na mga pamilya. They deserve justice. No? They deserve to know the truth. So, we need to bring out that truth. And if possible, we do it here in our country as well. Kasi yung ICC, Karen, pag pinasa mo yan sa ICC, and again, I'm in favor of going back to the ICC.
Yeah.
Ang ibig sabihin nun, hindi natin kayang i-resolve yan sa ating bansa. And para sa akin, masakit yun. Dapat, we should be able to resolve these issues in our own country, sa sarili nating bansa. Diba? Even before or alongside any process of foreign power.
Okay. The West Philippine Sea, in 2018 also, you called on former President Duterte to fight what is ours in the West Philippine Sea.
Atin to. Yung next guest mo ata, diba? Atin to.
Tama. So the irony is you have the case going to the arbitral ruling. This was brought to court during the time of the late President Noynoy Aquino, yes. Your cousin, yes. Uncle Cousin.
Cousin.
And now, President Marcos Jr. has exactly the same stand when it comes to the West Philippine Sea. I mean, talk about the irony, right, when it comes to certain issues here.
Well, alam mo, ako challenge ko yan, Karen. Yeah. I don't think it's ironic. Kasi yung ginawa naman ni Pinoy noon, tama eh. You know, yung pag pinaglaban niya yung bansa natin, and ginawa niya yung lahat na magagawa niya in his powers, and that was to bring it to the international court. So hindi ibig sabihin nun, just because si President Marcos ay President Marcos na gagawin niya yung kabaliktaran nun, that doesn't mean that that's what should happen. In fact, kung tama yun, dapat gawin nga yun. Diba? So I'm totally in favor of what the current administration is doing pagdating sa West Philippine Sea. Naninindigan sila. It's not easy to fight a big country like China. Hindi madali yun. And right now, they need our support to really protect our shores. Kailangan natin supportahan yan. I'm in the Multisectoral Council of the Air Force ever since I was in the Senate. So hanggang ngayon, nasa Multisectoral Council pa rin ako ng Air Force. And our military needs that support. Kasi outgunned and outshipped tayo dyan, di ba? So they need our support as Filipinos to show na nandun tayo sa likod nila.
Okay.
At kapag winawater cannon sila, dapat feeling natin, parang winawater cannon din tayo. Kung yung mangingisda, hindi binibigyan ng chance ang mangingisda doon, dapat ang feeling natin, nawawala rin yung hanap buhay natin.
And you don't think this administration is going to the extreme? I mean, during the time of the late President Aquino, there were criticisms that he pivoted to an extreme, which was too anti-China. With Duterte, too pro-China. Now, the criticism with Marcos Jr. is going to too pro-US.
Okay.
What are your thoughts?
Nobody wants war, Karen. Nobody wants war. I think when that was one thing I think that President Duterte said na sumang-ayon ako, na nobody wants war. Pero hindi naman ibig sabihin na maninindigan ka, magkakagera na kaagad. So you have to exhaust all means, locally, internationally, also play the game in terms of the world of press, diplomacy, and public opinion. Hindi lang ng Pilipinas, pero ng buong mundo. And of course, the U.S. can help you there. Pagdating dito sa issue ng China, no, nobody wants war. We don't want war. I don't even think China honestly wants war either. Pero kailangan, matigas tayo dyan, matibay tayo dyan. Hindi tayo nagbabago-bago ng posisyon. Yung mga teritoryong yan, atin yan. And we have to be clear with that position. At kailangan handa tayong ipaglaban yan sa kahit anumang arena. Diba? Whether it's in media, pagdating sa world public opinion, or sa korte, or sa mga international bodies. We have to do that. And we need to support that effort to make sure na klaro yan.
So clearly, you are not against President Marcos Jr. completely.
Karen, alam mo, yan kasi yung naging problema nung time ni President Duterte.
It became just an anti or pro.
Anti or pro.
Simplistic.
And parang, colors. Pati social media naging ganun.
Yeah.
Diba? So, pag galing sa amin, masama. Pag galing sa kanila, masama rin. Uh-huh. Hindi pwede yun, diba? Our country right now, nasa proseso tayo ng napakaraming mga kababayan natin ang naghihirap. And honestly, yung ganyang klaseng black and white na pag-iisip is not gonna help them.
Yeah.
We need to be able to see. Ang lente dapat natin, hindi partido mo, partido ko. Yung lente natin, ano yung kailangan ng bayan? Mm-hmm. Ano yung makakatulong sa tao? And right now, presyo ng bilihin, pagtaas ng sahod, education crisis, walang political dyan. Lahat yan, kailangan nating pagtulungan. Itong issue ng China, yes, there will be some people who may have a different position, but can't we agree na yung teritoryong yan, klaro naman na sa atin yan, dapat ipaglaban natin yan. So, there are so many issues na kailangan natin magtulungan para gumanda yung bayan natin, para makatulong tayo sa tao.
Oo.
And I've always had that position.
So, you're about moving forward, right? And removing the simplicity of labeling people to certain colors because it's much deeper than that, right?
I think, Karen, okay, siguro we will agree to disagree on many things. Mm. Maraming bagay yan nangyari sa ating kasaysayan, mga alliances, maraming mga bagay na maraming talagang hindi pagsasang-ayunan. Pero yung hinahanap kasi ng tao ngayon, ano yung makakatulong sa kanila? Paano natin sila pwedeng tulungan? And that's a space where I think we need to be able to set aside our own colors and see how we can help people.
Okay.
No, yun yung hinahanap ng tao. But that being said, klaro tayo na hindi tayo in favor of charter change. And honestly, ang
hindi ka in favor of charter change completely.
Of the political charter change. No? But, you know, Karen, I think right now, makikita mo yung kailangan ng tao. Hindi siya either dito tayo o dito tayo. In fact, ang nangyayari kasi ngayon, dahil nag-aaway na yung dalawang kampo, baka bumalik pa tayo dun eh.
Oo.
Na dalawang grupo lang yan. And mahalaga, for more people who can really try to bring back the discussion, ibalik natin sa tao. Ano ba talaga ang pera ng gobyerno, ang effort ng gobyerno, saan ba to dapat nakafocus? Nakafocus to sa pangangailangan ng tao. And I think in that sense, meron tayong espasyo doon na pwede tayong magsama-sama.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, before we continue, they're gonna ask you this as well. Because you are running for the Senate. Let me ask first this. Your reaction to Liberal Party President Edsel Agman saying the Liberal Party is going through the party list route to have a seat in Congress. This, as recent voter preference surveys showed, opposition bets trailing behind in the run up to the 2025 elections.
Actually, maraming mga magsusubok na mag-party list ngayon.
Uh-oh.
Na I think the LP will be running a party list as well. There are other groups. I know that there's a coalition right now na West Philippine Sea ang pinaka-issue nila, also running a party list group. Because nakikita ng mga grupong ito na kailangan mo ng representation in Congress and the Senate to be able to push for reforms. No?
And so, you support that?
Yes.
Yes. I mean, the Liberal Party, once the most powerful in the country, goes to a party list?
Yes, and there are many other groups, Karen, na magbubuo ng mga party list para may representation sila sa Kongreso.
Okay. All right. Here's a question for you. At the end of the day, you carry the Aquino legacy.
Yes.
And in fact, you've been said so many times to be like almost the twin of the late, the martyred Ninoy Aquino, right? The way you look alike. So I want to ask you certain things.
Sure.
you're not against the administration completely. You want to take it issue by issue. And yet, there are issues on the Marcos hidden wealth. You've seen him recently in an interview where an Australian journalist confronts him, where he supposedly laughs when asked about plunder issues. He's been asked recently in a press con why he hasn't apologized to the human rights violations. What are your thoughts on that? Why? What should he do?
Honestly, Karen, palagay ko, if we want to really move forward, magandang ma-address yun. Mm-hmm. No? Magandang ma-address yun. And the president has a few more years to be able to address those issues. I'm hoping if yung sinasabi naman niya, unity, kailangan mag-move forward, mag-move forward tayo pag na-address na yun.
Oo. Another issue is history. There's been talks on not teaching certain sections of our history, whether it's the issue of the Declaration of Martial Law, the dictatorship, or even recently some have said the lessening of the importance of what the late Ninoy Aquino has done, that part of history. What are your thoughts on that? Because in other parts of the world, regardless whether it's so dark, history is taught as it is.
Yes, it should be taught as it is, Karen. Nangyari yung mga nangyari. In martial law, in the past administration, nangyari yung mga nangyari. Hindi pwedeng mawala yon. And hindi lang ako to, bilang kamag-anak ni Ninoy Aquino, pero marami mga Pilipino, sa palagay ko, ang maninindigan na hindi pwedeng palitan ng ating kasaysayan. I think we can be very clear about that.
Okay. Your legacy when you were a senator, you've done a lot for MSMEs, but it's really the state, it's really the free SUCs.
Yes, free college, yes.
Free college. Some issues now have cropped up and said, dapat ba talagang i-free college?
Yes.
Ang UP, let me finish.
Iinis kasi ako sa... Naiinis kasi ako sa, alam mo, lahat ng mga tao nagsasabi, hindi dapat free ang college. Lahat sila, kaya naman magbayad ng college.
So, eto tanong ko. So, ang tanong is UP, right?
Okay.
So this was a discussion, of course, in On Head Start. Mm-hmm. Should UP be free? When? Let me first ask. Okay. Number one, you have one. The UPCAT is hard as it is to get into. So if you come from a private college, you have a bigger chance of passing the UPCAT, right? If you're from a private school, Ateneo La Salle, whatnot, etc. Number two, you have now really wealthy people in UP. And they are availing of free college. Okay. Nung time ko, it was subsidized.
Okay, Karen, okay.
Okay, UP, why should you give free college to wealthy kids in UP?
Okay, UP. We're talking just about UP.
UP, UP.
That's one out of 146 schools, okay? Yeah. Doon sa 145 schools na natitira, kung tama yung numbers natin, 80% to 90% ng mga estudyante dyan talagang nangangailangan ng tulong. So, may mga ilan kasi nagsasabi, tanggalin yung free college dahil sa UP, pointing to one school and wanting to repeal the whole law. Diba? So para sa akin, kalokohan yan. Okay? Kalokohan yan. Baka may ibang interest yung taong yan. But just UP. Okay. In the law, naglagay tayo dyan, students who understand that they can afford can actually pay full tuition.
Huh?
So there is a mechanism
may there. Ganun.
Yes,
there so is a mechanism. So parang konsensya to.
Yes. So baka ang tanong, since may issue kayo sa UP, taga-UP ka, di ba?
UP ako. Oh,
may issue ka.
Oo.
Then maybe the alumni should talk to the studentry and to the parents of the students and say, kung anak ka naman ng CEO ng kung anumang kumpanya, or anak ka naman ng gobernador o ng whoever, bayad ka naman ng full tuition. Uh-oh. And that can be done without changing the law. There's a mechanism there.
But pero that was never discussed.
It's never discussed, but it's there. There's an option to pay full tuition for all the schools. For all the schools.
Uh-oh.
Pero kasi Karen, yung kabaliktaran kasi niyan, kung gagawin mo ulit yung iimbestigahan mo, lahat ng mga estudyante, yung cost lang noon, nilagay mo nilang sana sa scholarship.
Oo. Ginagawa yun nun eh. I remember, pumupunta sa bahay mo.
Ilan yung refrigerator mo? Ilan yung TV mo?
Ilan ang electric fan mo? Naka-aircon ka ba?
I remember. Just that program, ang laking stress na nun sa mga magulang. Kasi sabi nila, pwede ba akong bumili ng isa pang electric fan? Baka mawala scholarship ng anak ko. It's absurd, di ba?
So
maybe for UP, you don't have to change the law. Tingnan na lang yung mga estudyante kung talagang may kaya ka. Siguro naman kung naka-BMW ka, pupunta ka ng UP.
Yeah, may mga ganun eh.
Magbayad ka naman ng full tuition.
Oh, oh.
But that can be done through the internal workings of the school. Hindi na yan kailangan palitan yung batas.
That's a good one. Why wasn't that ever discussed?
Kayo yung mga alumni, pag-usapan nyo.
I didn't even know, frankly, that that was a part in the law.
It's there.
That you can encourage those who can afford to pay full tuition, because that's a good, that works in the reverse. Eh. What you do is actually talk about, you appeal to the conscience.
And my social pressure yan.
Yeah, of diba? The one who can afford.
Ako, honestly, just get, let's start out with 5% of students and their parents to say, you know, ito, scholar tayo ng bayan, so we will pay back and we will give back the full payment of our tuition. Start with that 5%, lalaki at lalaki yan because of the social pressure.
Okay, so if you win as a senator, what will be, I know binanggit mo na, pagbaba ng presyo ng bilihin, you've named it all. Ano ang magiging advocacy mo ulit? Mm-hmm. What is there a law that you want to pet? Like, yes. You have a pet law?
Ano siya, Karen? It's really cost of living. Right now, nararamdaman to ng napakarami nating kababayan. Even up to the middle class, nararamdaman na to na yung kinikita ko, hindi na sapat sa pangangailangan ko. Mm-hmm. Now, what do I want to do in the Senate? Unang-una, lahat ng mga kabataan na gusto mag-aral, pwede makapagtapos, pwede makakuha ng trabahong maganda.
Okay.
Pangalawa, kung ako handa magtrabaho, yung kinikita ko, sapat para sa pamilya ko. Simple lang, di ba? Mm-hmm. Pangatlo, yung tulong ng gobyerno na pupunta sa akin para ako rin kaya kong tumulong sa kapwa Pilipino ko. Let's focus on those three. That's what people are looking for. Can you help me earn more? Can you help me have more benefits para kaya yung mga kulang at kapos, kaya kong matawid yon? And of course, last, yung presyo ng bilihin. Na honestly, Karen, malaking part ng presyo ng bilihin natin, korupsyon. Kung yan, ma-address natin yan, kayang bumaba ang presyo ng bilihin natin, mas makakahinga ang taong bayan.
Mm. All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, former Senator Bam Aquino.